Welcome to this week's edition of World Crisis Radio. This is Webster Tarpley speaking to you from Washington, D.C. Let me, right off the bat, remind people that the Left Forum is held at the end of May, beginning of June in New York City. And this year it's going to be at the John Jay College of Criminal Justice, I think. And I'm going to be speaking at this august event Saturday. Let's see, the Saturday at the end of the month, whatever it is. I guess it's the 30th of May, unless I'm mistaken. Let me just check this. Saturday, the 30th of May. Yes, sorry, May 31st. Saturday, May 31st. In New York City, this is in session 3 on Saturday afternoon, 3:20 p.m. to 4:50 p.m. in room 1.117. Again, the Left Forum, look it up on the internet. Left Forum, New York City, Saturday, May 31st, 3:20 p.m. it starts. Room 1.117, John Jay College of Criminal Justice. I think this is over on the west side in Midtown. And the title is The Left's Role in the Neoliberal Imperialism, Syria, Ukraine, and Libya. And of course, you can, start from there and go to a number of different, different points. Now, lots of things, happening here in Washington this week was primarily the week of Syria, because we've had the visit of Jarba, the representative of these mercenaries and killers from the Syrian National Coalition and the Free Syrian Army. And these characters, of course, as always, want money. So they can live in hotels, but above all now they want Stinger missiles, they want anti-tank missiles, and so forth. So Jarba got to cavort in public with Skull and Bones Kerry, and Jarba also met with Obama. We also had at the same time Fabius, the foreign minister of France, complaining that French imperialism didn't get what they wanted. They wanted, obviously, to make a big return to Syria by bombing it and taking who knows what after that. But this didn't happen, as we know, thank God, thanks to the Russian intervention. Fabius has still not gotten over that. Fabius is still whining that Obama refused to bomb Syria. And, of course, France didn't want to act alone. Why don't you act alone, France? See how you like it. See what it's like. Take it on the chin a few times, and maybe you'll... Your warmonger spirits will die down there in the Vichyssoise faction represented by Fabius. So between Jarba and Fabius, we had this clique that we know is operating behind the scenes, right? Kerry, not even behind the scenes, but Kerry, Samantha Power, General David Petraeus, and General Jack Keane, with, of course, the entire Kagan clan, Kimberly Kagan, the Institute for the Study of War, and then by extension, Robert Kagan of the Brookings Institution and his charming wife, Madame Victoria Nuland. So that entire neocon, warmonger cabal, up in arms, trying to get the bombing of Syria. And we've just had the meeting then of the Friends of Syria meeting in London, that is to say on Thursday. And what you notice is that Syria seems to have fewer and fewer friends as the terrorist rebels are driven out of cities. This past week, we have the definitive end of the fighting around the city of Homs. And I congratulate Homs on having held out in the cause of civilization and having asserted civilization over barbarism by driving out the terrorist rebels. Unfortunately, the fact that those rebels were able to transfer themselves out has led to some momentary deterioration in the Aleppo area, because they had to go somewhere, and I guess they decided to go back to the battlefront. But that will not, I trust, last too long, especially with Bandar transferring his fighters into Ukraine, as we know. So there's no formal statement in the U.S. press that the U.S. has decided to send in these sophisticated weapons that the rebels have been demanding the entire time. And remember, the slaughter plan, Anne-Marie Slaughter, Nomen Est Omen, has been demanding behind the scenes, you want to strike Putin, you've got to do it through Syria. It's too dangerous to do it in Ukraine, okay, I know you're reluctant, says Anne-Marie Slaughter, so therefore we're going to counterattack Putin in Syria by depriving him of his ally there. This is all absolute insanity, and of course, it simply stokes the fires of terrorism, which the U.S. is supposed to oppose. And the fear in some of the coverage of this Syria week here, the fear, of course, that lots and lots of terrorist crazies are going to be coming back to the U.S. is everywhere. Now, concerning Ukraine, London Economist editorial here last week, what would America fight for, with a nice eagle on the cover of the May 3rd to May 9th London Economist? Well, what would the U.S. fight for? I tell you, national defense. Defense against foreign attack, I guess. But not for the kinds of geopolitical manipulations that the city of London has been inflicting on the world for about 400 years. So the meddlers of London, just like the meddlers of Paris with Fabius, are invited to shut up, or put up, or shut up. Very unlikely that any of these Weltmachtruinen, these ruins of ex-world powers, are likely to do anything alone, or even the two of them together. The U.S. line is now that Moscow is somehow responsible for the success of the Ukrainian elections in 2 weeks, the Ukrainian fascist clique. And we know now that the son of Biden, not Beau Biden, but the younger son of Vice President Biden, is on the board of a Ukrainian gas company. You can get the details on this off my Twitter page. And so we've got absolute rampant nepotism, conflict of interest, corruption. A friend of the Kerry Heinz family is also on the board, and the son of Joe Biden. So these people are cashing in. And, of course, the demand for sanctions will raise the price of gas in Ukraine so that these characters can carry out primitive accumulation against the Ukrainian population. There is a report from the United Nations on Ukraine, which obviously whitewashes that massacre in Odessa 2 weeks ago. We're getting all sorts of reports. One interesting report is this telephone conversation where we learn from two friends of Kolomoisky that the oligarch Kolomoisky is the one who sent in some of the teams that eventually did much of the killing. The claim is that Kolomoisky didn't really want them to kill quite so many people, but that's anybody's guess. There's also an account of what happened from the Russian journal Antifascist. So you want to take a look at Antifascist online, right? Use your Google translator. And remember, the land of the oligarchs is now Ukraine. Poroshenko, the chocolate king of the British Cadbury and world cocoa cartel centered in London, this Poroshenko is now the expected candidate to win the election. And we've seen the wonderful democracy in Ukraine, Turchinov, the president, cutting off the head of the Communist Party and saying he wants to ban the Communist Party opposition. Great, great way to run a presidential campaign. Back in a minute. Welcome back to World Crisis Radio. So remember, Left Forum, New York City, on Saturday the 31st of May, John Jay College. I'll be starting in a panel at about 3:20 in the afternoon. So if you're in the metropolitan area, then Of course, you're invited to drop by. We want to say a few words about Tsipras and the European Parliament. We're going to have to fit that in. Let me focus on the really big event, though, which is this question of what's going to happen with the Russian economy. At the same time that the Friends of Syria was meeting in London, we've got Haig, the British Foreign Secretary, talking about Ukraine and boasting that there will soon be various kinds of U.S. sanctions. Western allies prepare wider Russian sanctions. And this, of course, has got to do with this, the expectation that Russia somehow has to guarantee the success of this election. But here is now the problem. We have been following the proposals of Sergei Glazyev, the dirigist, protectionist, neo-mercantilist candidate for to be the principal economic policymaker in Russia. It is the case that in the past, Glazyev has been an asset of the Kremlin to put forward certain ideas to see how they are going to be received. Now, Glazyev's most recent statements are that Russia is being pushed out of the dollar zone by the sanctions championed by the United States and Britain. And Glazyev has a track record of being in favor of de-emphasizing the dollar and emphasizing payments in rubles, also in the international sphere. Now, the big event here is going to be Putin's trip to China, and that is next week. The 20th of May, Putin goes to China. This is a golden opportunity to use, to mobilize, the BRICS bank. Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. The BRICS bank could be mobilized as the alternative to the International Monetary Fund that it always should have been. And it has lost momentum, it has lost resources compared to what it was supposed to be. But now, under these conditions of emergency and imminent actual financial warfare, it may be possible to convince these people to go over the top. Now, we've also got the coming of Modi. Now, I don't know what's with Modi. I can't give you an opinion on Modi. All I can say is the Indians who voted for Modi in large number, you can see what it is they want. They want bullet trains. They want hydroelectric power. They want manufacturing hubs. They want modern technology. They want roads. They want superhighways. They want airports. They want mass transit. Rural electrification, that's apparently one of the biggest things that Modi is identified with, rural electrification. And this is a stunning reverse for people in Europe, right? The décroissance, décrescita, or the people here, right, who are so worried about pipelines or transportation projects or whatever it is. In other words, the entire decadent anti-development world of the West is repudiated once again by a healthier polity where we have Modi says he wants to be the development man. Well, we need a development man, too, here in the U.S. Now, what do we have? The point of Glazyev, though, is to say that if you simply give money to banks, this is how he puts it, if currency issue is simply given to banks for speculation, that then becomes inflation. If it's for refinancing of the real sector and investment in the modernization of scientific and technological potential, then it's anti-inflationary. As we've always said, money that is channeled into production, be it agriculture, industry, infrastructure, and things of this sort, is actually deflationary. It's only if you insist on putting it into the rotten derivatives speculative universe. Now, Glazyev, according to these magazines, Vedomosti and Moscow Komsomolets, right? The Glazyev plan contains 15 points, and some of them we know to move dollar and euro assets out of NATO into neutral areas, bring back as much of the assets and accounts as possible to Russia. He's on record as saying that if the U.S. insists on going ahead with sanctions, then obviously Russia will not be able to earn the foreign exchange needed to pay U.S. loans to Russia, and therefore that will have to be defaulted on. Sell the bonds of NATO countries. In other words, it means dump treasuries. And Russia, of course, has several hundred million. Estimates have gone up to half a billion at different times. Now, two points I think are important. One is this question of capital controls, exchange controls. And even though he doesn't use these words, in point eight, we have limits to the foreign currency positions of banks. In other words, speculation, buying, you know, controlling large blocks of foreign currency, and prior notification of currency transactions that are not connected to physical goods. In other words, outside of commerce and trade, if you're going to, you know, move $1 trillion into collateralized debt obligations in London or credit default swaps in New York, you've got to tell the government, you've got to notify the Russian finance ministry of that. Introduce a tax on capital export and financial speculation. Now, the tax on financial speculation, what could it be? It's essentially the Russian version of a Wall Street sales tax. This stuff is highly interesting. So we have the practical equivalent of capital controls and exchange controls. And then, of course, the big point that he comes up with is 12. To the extent you can't borrow from the dollar zone, or the eurozone for that matter, you replace dollar and euro credit coming from foreign countries, and for state corporations and state-owned banks, you replace those with ruble loans. In other words, national credit coming from the Russian central bank. And the goal here is he wants to channel this through the VEB Bank. The VEB Bank becomes the agent of the Russian Central Bank in putting out these loans so that you can replace what you cannot get anymore from the West. And that's the equivalent of long-term, low-interest credit for production. Back in a minute. Welcome back to World Crisis Radio. We're looking forward to the European Parliament elections in about 2 weeks, and we want you to pay attention to the Tsipras candidacy. We'll say something about this in a minute. But right now, here in the U.S., we've been highlighting the case of Reverend Edward Pinckney of Benton Harbor, Michigan, and how he has been harassed, jailed, in effect, put under house arrest by the police state set up there by Governor Snyder. And now we see that this is a pattern. The same dirty MO that was used against Reverend Pinckney has now been used against Congressman John Conyers, one of the deans of the Black Caucus and one of the pillars of the Democratic faction there in the House of Representatives. And there's an attempt to throw him off the ballot and using precisely these technicalities. The American Civil Liberties Union has announced an attempted lawsuit to remove the necessity of having the witnesses, the people who gather signatures for an election petition. You wouldn't have to be a registered voter in order to do that. They're trying to get Congressman Conyers on the ballot. But I want to go now to Reverend Pinckney, get an update on his situation and how he sees now that his case is not isolated, but a broad pattern of fascism in Michigan in particular. Are you there, Reverend?
Yes, I am. Webster, I tell you, I'm excited today. I tell you, every single day, Webster, is a battle here in the state of Michigan. Fascism is here. They're taking over everything in this city and trying to neutralize the people. What happened to John Conyers is really criminal. You see, what they're doing to him, they know it's wrong. But the people are going to have to stand up, Webster, and say no more. Until they do that, we're going to continue fighting this battle.
Okay, well, what's the immediate situation with your case, and then we maybe go on to counter moves on the Conyers front.
Absolutely. Let me say this. On last Thursday, we filed a criminal complaint against Mayor James Hightower. And what happened is amazing. We know that he manufactured the evidence to start the investigation to stop the election for May 6th. We know that. That's a fact, because we have the evidence to support it. We sent the evidence to the prosecutor office. We sent it to the judge who set aside the election. We sent it to the election board, the attorney general, and the Justice Department. We have not heard back from the Justice Department, nor have we heard back from the prosecutor. So on Monday, we're calling a press conference. We're going to let the people know about this mayor who supports the corporations, who support Whirlpool here in the city. And we're going to challenge them to either arrest this man or release me. You got your choice. Either arrest Mayor James Hightower for manufacturing evidence or release Reverend Pinckney right now. That's the only options you have, because they have the evidence to support what we're saying. Yet and still, they're trying to hold out to get this PGA in. See, this PGA is big business for them. They get the TV rights, and the city of Benton Harbor suffers. We get nothing. We have to pay for security. We have to pay for all these other things. And yet and still, they're talking about what they're doing. That's why we have to fight them. We have to show them what we're capable of doing and continue to fight. But the last note I'm going to say about this, we got them on the run, Webster.
Mm-hmm.
We got them on the run like never before. They never dreamed that this would happen.
All right, Reverend. Let's repeat how people can help you directly. You got legal fees. How many days have you now been held under house arrest?
I have been held for 22 days.
22 days.
This 22 days under house arrest. 22 days I could not use my computer. 22 days where the sheriff's department patrolling my home. Every hour they're patrolling my home, trying to find out what I'm doing and what I might be doing, and trying to silence me completely. But here's how they can help me. You can mail a check to Banco, B-A-N-C-O, 1940 Union Avenue, Benton Harbor, Michigan, 49022. That's Banco. B-A-N-C-O, 1940 Union Avenue, Benton Harbor, Michigan, 49022. Or you can go to my website, bhbanco.org, bhbanco.org. You can push a button and you can donate right online. And I tell you, Webster, I'm excited. I tell you, this is the first time probably in the history where we think we got them where we want them.
And are there any plans to hold something, you know, statewide or something that would bring together your cause with Conyers and presumably others who are getting the same treatment?
Absolutely. Matter of fact, when I get off the phone with you, get off this radio show, I'm going to call Conyers' office and in partnership with him to fight this monster. And to me, that's important. Also, we have an Occupy the PGA May 24th here. We're having a mass demonstration, and we're going to combine John Conyers issues with Reverend Pinckney issue, Detroit issue with Benton Harbor issues, and we're going to merge them so people can understand that we're here and we're here for each other.
And I'm sure that that's happening to other people, right, maybe who don't have the publicity or the organization that you have and certainly what Conyers has.
Oh, absolutely. It's happening all across the country. Very few people are able to fight back. You can't fight this. See, when you fight back, you're fighting against the house. It's like going to a gambling casino, you see, and you're fighting against the house. They always say the house wins, but we're going to show them that we can stop this house. We can beat the house, and we're going to do it anytime something like this comes up. I am 100% in support of John Conyers. And I want him to know that. I've been knowing him for years, and he don't deserve this. But the power to be...
Briefly, we have limited time, but any media there, anywhere in Michigan, Detroit, Lansing, Benton Harbor, where you are, has any media put this stuff together and sort of sounded the alarm?
Oh, absolutely not. The corporate media will not listen. That, I mean, what they're saying, they're trying to demonize, actually, John Conyers. They're demonizing him. You know they're going to demonize me, but John Conyers?
Yeah,
that's incredible. Who would believe that they would go out of their way to demonize a man like John Conyers? It just doesn't add up.
All right, so it's Banco, B-A-N-C-O, and the address is 1940 Union Avenue, Benton Harbor, Michigan, 49022. Did I get that right?
You hit it right on the nose. You're right there.
All right.
Absolutely.
I think it's a worthy cause, people.
Absolutely. Let's keep fighting, Webster. Let's keep showing them what we're going to do, and we're going to merge with John Conyers and fight this monster together.
And let me just ask you, is there some deadline coming up? Or?
May 30th, I will be going into the courtroom.
Okay.
And that's May 30th at 8:30 in the morning in St. Joseph, Michigan. And that will be one of the most dramatic meetings that we have had inside the courtroom in years.
Okay. Concerning your press conference on Monday, I would strongly recommend that you find a way to stream it, right? Put it on the internet, and maybe with various, we could do a Twitter campaign and get some international
interest. I have somebody here to videotape it.
Okay, and we can stream that.
And then we can put it on the internet.
Okay. Thank you, Reverend. We want to hear from
you
again next week. We're going to follow you as long as you're not free. We want to put you on every week, so we'll see you again next week.
All right, then. Looking forward to it.
Bye-bye, then.
Bye now.
Keep up the good fight.
Okay.
We'll be back in just a minute on World Crisis Radio. All right, so we want to do everything we can for Reverend Pinckney. You can see that this is a much bigger thing, right? This is the continuation of the disenfranchising, taking away people's right to vote. Well, the flip side of that is taking away the right of people who want to be candidates to be candidates. And when they take away the candidate, they're actually taking away your right to vote. Look at it that way. So this is not somebody getting on the ballot. This is your ability to vote for the candidate of your choice. And now you see that spreading all over Michigan. All right. Now, concerning votes, we've just had some Republican primaries here in the past several days. And the Tuesday primaries, out of all of them, the one that got the most attention on the domestic hour of National Public Radio this morning is Ben Sasse of Nebraska, and he is now obviously the darling of the Republican establishment. Here's somebody with an elitist resume, Yale, Oxford, but also has worked for just about every establishment, Wall Street political institution. And we now have the interesting perspective that it's going to be Sasse against the Democrat domina, but at least in all likelihood, there's also a third party, and it looks like the Tax Wall Street Party may have something to say about the Senate race in Nebraska. So to get a line on that, let's go to Daniela Walls. Are you there, Daniela?
Hi, Webster. How are you?
We're fine. Great to have you back. You're much in demand from this audience. So
thank you.
You're up to speed now.
It's been a long time. Let's get into Sasse a little bit later because he's an interesting case. But the Democratic Party in Nebraska acts like a third party, so I say we skip Domina for today, and we'll talk a little
Domina.
Bit about
that's
Sasse.
Exactly right. Let's hear about the new challenge from the Tax Wall Street Party.
Yeah. So if we have time, we'll get into Sasse at the end. But I know we have limited time. But we have a campaign headquarters downtown in Lincoln here. And I think we're running an historic U.S. Senate campaign. Dan Burdorf is the Tax Wall Street Party candidate.
You better spell that name.
Dan, B-U-H-R-D-O-R-F. I'm sorry. Dan, B-U-H-R-D-O-R-F.
Dan Burdorf is the candidate.
And please read his platform at danfornebraska.com. And there's more details than we can get into here, but we're bringing back economic populism and the roots of the New Deal to Nebraska in the midst, Webster, of Tea Party madness. Unlike any other candidate I've known in my life, Dan is in service to a program, and the program's on his website, danfornebraska.com. And the program is designed to pull Americans out of the economic depression. So candidates, as you know, usually don't serve a program, and that's the territory of revolutionaries. So I think this makes Dan almost a great American revolutionary at this moment, and he needs your support. We have some great student support at the University of Nebraska. We have student groups coming out for us. So he's filling an empty Senate seat vacated by Mike Johanns. So there's no incumbent in this race, and it's a red state, and Sass just won the primary. So that leaves one Tea Party senator in office, this Deb Fischer that everybody thinks is a buffoon. So Nebraska is already in the danger zone, Webster, with these Tea Partiers, and Deb Fischer is a real wing nut and unpopular. Nobody likes her, and everybody's regretful that she's senator. She'll probably be primary next election, so then we're going to end up getting another Tea Party guy in there unless we fight back. So Dan, B-U-H-R-D-O-R-F, is our candidate for U.S. Senate. Again, danfornebraska.com, and America couldn't do better than Dan. He gets history and has a broad perspective on what's worked best in our past. He's bringing none of this newfangled Tea Party reactionary garbage or this green hooey, Webster. Dan's bringing economic populism back to the heartland, exactly the place where it began.
Daniela, why don't you read off some of his program points so people get an idea of that?
Okay, well, we're just, hold on, let me go to his program. Well, tax Wall Street, not Main Street, and so building a new infrastructure, taking back the Federal Reserve, restoring American industry and family farms, fixing Obamacare, making college affordable, and what Dan's really excited about is a global peace race and bringing things like the new maglev. You know, China's building this new maglev, and they even said they wanted to stretch their maglev from China to America, and the big joke is, well, what's going to happen when the train gets to America? It's just going to stop. So those are, but I want everybody to go, because I know we have 10 minutes, to the website, and it's all laid out there, and you can read everything.
Okay, danfornebraska.com, danfornebraska.com. And can you just walk them through it? They want to be among the first to contribute to this effort.
Exactly. Most important is that Sass, like you said, just won the primary, and he's totally Wall Street funded. He's not an outsider, as he claims. And at the moment, we're struggling to do all this with no money, and while still making progress, but it's been just volunteerism and grassroots support. But we could do so much with a few dollars. Sass, as a candidate, has always been like a blue-chip prospect for Wall Street waiting in the wings. I went to the donor list and on the federal election website, and his first donor, everybody can do this, but his first donor is Chase. Second is Goldman Sachs, Webster. So his biggest overall donor as well, and you know a lot about this because I've heard you talk about it before, but his biggest overall donor coming in at almost $1 million is the Club for Growth. And you've talked about them on your show. The Koch brothers, I believe this to be correct, funds the Club for Growth. And it's part of what we're calling here the Koch Brothers Plantation Plan for Nebraska, which is to turn Nebraska into a Koch state, just like Kansas, like you said, is with Senator Brownback. So like I said, we're going up against a wall of Wall Street money and Koch Brothers money.
A wall of money.
A wall of money, yeah, Wall Street and Koch Brothers money. So all the donations are public information on the federal election website. Anybody can go take a look. If you just go to the FEC.gov, you can type in Sass's name for yourself and take a look. People need to start doing this. It's just one Wall Street bank after the next. It's obscene. Then think about whether, I guess, you want your name to appear forever on Dan Burdorf's Tax Wall Street Party with the donors. If you donate, Dan, you have a lot of people.
the American. Claim your first fight and donate to a new deal candidate. And again, you can donate at danforthepresta.com. At the site, you can donate via PayPal or send a check made out to our PO Box friends, a check made out to friends of Dan Bernworth. And the PO Box is 6584, Lincoln, Nebraska, 68506. All this information is on the website, but PO Box 6584, Lincoln, Nebraska, 68506. Check made out to friends of Dan Bernworth or by PayPal under the donate button.
Okay, now you're still getting signatures to get on the ballot, right?
We're still getting signatures.
So people who are in Nebraska and who are, I guess, Nebraska registered voters, I believe you can be registered as anything. You can be registered as a Democrat, a Republican, an independent, whatever you are. You can come out and help Dan get signatures, right?
Yes. If you're in Nebraska, contact us on the website, and we do need volunteers. We have a nice core group with the students. And this office we have with some loyal friends of Dan's, but please, we need extra people. We'd love to have any
okay.
help.
Okay, Daniela, we'll be having you back soon again to give us some updates on this. In the meantime, it's danfornebraska.com.
Okay, thank you, Webster.
See you next week or thereabouts. Back in a minute. Welcome back to the second hour of World Crisis Radio, and if all goes well, this is a special occasion because we're going to be joined, I believe. I wonder if the control room can confirm. Are we, in fact, getting through? Okay, so we're now joined by one of the most distinguished European historians of the current age. It is Annie Lacroix. It's written LACROIX-RIZ. She is Professor Emerita, I believe, at the University of Paris 7.
Yes.
She is one of the most successful and noted mavericks in the entire world of historical research in Europe, and in particular...
Nice of you.
Two books that I would like to point to. Right? One is called The Choice of Defeat.
Yes.
The thesis here is essentially that the French ruling class, the financiers of the Bank of France and the Banque Worms, W-O-R-M-S, written Worms, that that group in Paris deliberately wanted Hitler to defeat France in the spring of 1940, and that they used their two organizations, the so-called Synarchists or Synarchy organization, high-level group, and then the operative arm of that, known as the Cagoule, the hooded gang, right? And we've talked in the past on this show about how the people who wanted to overthrow Roosevelt in the 1930s were learning lessons from the 1934 attack on the French National Assembly. She's got another book called From Munich to Vichy, which is a story about how the French Republic was destroyed, Hitler from the outside, and this French pro-fascist group from the inside. She has also written about the role of the Vatican, Pius XII, and other forces in promoting the rise of fascism in Europe. She's written, I believe, two books on the corruption of the historical profession in our time. And the thing that I wanted to start with, I hope we can get to talk about a number of those points, but the first one has to do with Ukraine and the so-called Holodomor, the idea that there was a deliberately created genocidal famine in Ukraine in, 1933, 1934, and that this had been politically imposed by Stalin and others. And she finds that, let's get her to tell us. Welcome, Madame Rie.
Hello.
Hello, we're so happy to have you.
I'm happy too.
So please tell us now. Let's start with the Holodomor and your research on that.
It's not specifically my study, but once with my students, I had to publish or to give them original text about the situation in Russia and, of course, Ukraine in the 30s. And I discovered in diplomatic papers that what was called the Ukrainian famine was appeared very differently in these papers. because so I wrote no book, but I spoke of the problem in my last books. But I made a notebook about that. It's on my website, a text of 60 pages with the diplomatic papers and my critics about the papers. You know, it's a critical presentation of diplomatic papers. And it it may be described as I'm going to try to do. There was in Ukraine, in Soviet Union, and mostly in Ukraine, but not only in Ukraine, there was a very severe drought, a double problem for harvest. A very severe drought in 1932-33, very severe drought, not only in Ukraine, but in the south of Soviet Union. And, of course, the harvest was severely diminished by this drought. And the social and political situation was still how could I say? I've forgotten the adjective.
It was very tense. It was conflictual.
It was marked by the consequences of collectivization and anger among rich peasantry. Peasants were called kulaks, and this anger was exploited by Germany and German agents, and it's a this is a specific problem for Ukraine, which we talk about that on the more general question of Ukraine, because Ukraine was a very important target, political and mostly economic target for Germany, and. Its agents took advantage of the political situation and tried, mostly at the beginning of the 30s and still more when Nazis came to power, to exploit this social problem. And for instance, the attaché in the German embassy in Moscow, Otto Schiller, who was mostly devoted to country problems, harvest problems, and so on, right, played an important part. And what shows, it was among the texts I discovered, what showed that there was still no famine in 93, in the beginning of 93, in February 93, he published a report, a very long report, which has been translated in French. It's in the Quai d'Orsay archives, in the archives of French Foreign Office. And this report speaks about the awful Soviet organization, but there is no word about famine. And the situation was very difficult at the end of 33, at the beginning of 30, at the end of 32, at the beginning of 33, because in the period between the exhaustion of the old harvest and the new harvest, but not only in Ukraine, because the diplomatic papers showed that the rationing, the food rationing, was more severe in the north of Russia, for instance, in Leningrad and Moscow, than in the southern country. And the
hang on 1 second. The music tells us that we've just got one of our inevitable station breaks for some advertising, and we'll be right back with Annie Lacroix-Rie, distinguished French historian, on the question of the Holodomor in Ukraine and other topics. Back in a minute. Welcome back to World Crisis Radio. Webster Carpenter here in Washington. Very happy to be joined by Annie Lacroix-Rie, French historian, who has written on any number of topics, 20th century history in particular. And she's in the course of telling us that the so-called deliberately provoked famine in Ukraine in the early 1930s was not Ukrainian and was a result more of natural causes, lack of water, a drought, and not so much the result of any political decision. Is that about right?
Yes, but I think that the political situation in Ukraine was important too, because Germans asked, it was not difficult to ask them, asked rich peasants to keep the harvest, to keep the grains during the difficult period between the old harvest and the new harvest. But what is important too is that the food shortage didn't strike only Ukraine, but all the south of Russia, Caucasus, Kazakhstan, and so on. And that's the first problem. The second problem is that we are sure, absolutely sure, that the difficult food situation really stopped, in the summer of 1933, with a very good harvest in July 33. And what's remarkable is that the campaign, the political campaign, just began in the summer of 1933. And I think we might speak of the campaign, speaking generally of the Ukrainian question. And there's something very important which makes very nervous the historians who talk in France. I think of Nicolas Vert, who talk of the genocide or a genocide famine in Ukraine. You know, there is no photographs. There is no one photograph of the Ukrainian famine in 1933. I'm absolutely categoric on this point. And these last days, I was interviewed by a French journalist with Nicolas Vert, and Nicolas Vert got very nervous because he had to acknowledge that all the photos published since the 30s, because as I said, the campaign began in 1933, organized by Germany, Poland, Vatican, I might say all the German allies. All the photo published since 1933, as far as the present times, are old photos of the frightful famine of 1921, which is, as you know, the consequence of the foreign war imposed upon the Russian people because of this revolution. It was not, as it's so often said, only a civil war. It was, as French leader said in 1937, French Prime Minister Sautant said, speaking of the war in Spain, it was a civil foreign war. And a writer who was before writing a photographer, a professional photographer, Douglas Turtle, wrote a book that any listener might download, because it has been out of print since for a long time. The book is the name of the book. The title of the book is Fraud, Famine, and Fascism: The Ukrainian Genocide Myth from Hitler to Harvard. And it has been written in 1987. You have the physical proof that no photo has been taken in 1933. And it was like that in 1987. It's still like that. And when I said to the journalist I spoke of, that it's a problem because every people making a paper on the Ukrainian famine, mostly when is the famine is said to be a Stalinian genocide, are that kind of photos, or it's impossible to hide. This kind of things. You know, it was forbidden to photograph Jewish slaughter. It was absolutely forbidden. We have millions of photos. There is no event, even strictly forbidden for photographer. There is no event in the 20th century that has not been photographed.
All right, and, so and, the, and the story it's, of it's the famine...
It's a problem. The myth of genocide cannot settle, you know. And I show the listener may read on my website, of course in French, but they may read the 60 pages of text and critics I've published on this thing, and we must explain why the famine campaigns begin just when the food shortage stopped. There was no famine in 34, 35, 36. It was over, you know, and that's the problem of the political campaign. The political campaigns are all linked to the more general question of Ukraine.
Okay, hold that thought. We'll be back in 1 second after the pause. Annie Lacroix, French historian on Ukraine in the 1930s. We're going to bring it up to the present time to some extent. Back in a minute. Welcome back to World Crisis Radio. We're continuing our conversation with Annie Lacroix, French historian. So what we've come to now is that the deliberate famine in Ukraine is a myth, and it stretches from Hitler to Harvard. I would just like to ask one more question about this. You mentioned Germany, Poland, the Vatican. I think you've also written about fascist Italy being a part of this. But how about the William Randolph Hearst Press here in the United States.
Yes. William Randolph Hearst was one of the leaders of this campaign, because this campaign was very hard in the United States and Canada mostly, and almost as much as in Germany and its allies. Of course, and what is most important is that campaign soared every time Ukraine was a terrible stake in international questions. That is very often in the 30s, in the 40s, of course, in the during the Second World War, after the war. In the Reagan years, it terribly soared in the 80s, and that's why Douglas Total was interested in the question. And as you know, when the United States these last years began to wanted to have a definite grip on Ukraine with the Orange Revolution and so on, the campaign soared anew. And I think many people don't know the aspect of the campaign. You know, when I was attacked in these last years, because I had published these diplomatic papers, I was attacked by Ukrainian associations, which had a leader. The leader was the Ukrainian World Congress in Washington.
Right.
And this Congress, who had an official protection, led by Ashkold Luzhinsky, led a terrible campaign, not only an anti-Soviet campaign, but as in the situation of nowadays, the last month situation with anti-Semitic arguments, you know. In 2002, he wrote to the New York Times, to the magazine New York Times, this letter. It dates back to July 18, 2002. And he replied to a reader who had sent to the New York Times a letter about the myth of the genocide, of the Stalinian genocide. And that's what he wrote. Dear editor, reading what happened to Uncle Schmiel by a Jewish reader who talk about the terrible anti-Semitism in Ukraine, and mostly in Western Ukraine, which was not Soviet during the interwar, which was Polish at that time, you know, because Ukraine was severed, and a big part of it, the Western part of it, went to Poland.
And this is the famous city of Lvov. So Lvov was Poland.
Yes, the western part, what has been called the Curzon Line,
right,
which was the ethnic limit was not respected in the 20s, and with the protection of France, Poland. Which was the leader of what was called the cordon sanitaire, took a big part of Ukraine. And I come back to Luzhinsky. He says, I was struck in particular by Daniel Mendelssohn's statement that thanks to the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact, the Soviets took over Western Ukraine in 1939, and the Jews there had 2 years of relative security. And that's what Lozhinsky replies. I quote, I only quote, the Soviet occupation of Western Ukraine, that is Polish Ukraine, in 1939 brought about the arrest and internment of tens of thousands of Ukrainians accused of patriotic activity. These Ukrainians were mostly Bandera Ukrainians, or the emeritus of the pogromists of the 20s.
Right.
When the Soviets, you will see the anti-Semitism of the writing. When the Soviets were forced to retreat from the invading Nazis in June 1941, they slaughtered their prisoners. This was accomplished with the assistance of local communists, primarily of Jewish ethnicity, and so on and so on. All the rest of the letter is a slander against Bolshevik who are Jewish, and the myth of a slaughter made by the Jews. Norman Davies, that is what we call in France revisionist historians, but in France the term revisionist is very negative. It's not the same meaning as in French, It mostly means negationist.
Holocaust denial, in other words.
Yes, who denied the right. existence of the ways of slaughtering Jews. Norman David, the renowned British historian, has concluded that no nation knows more people in the 20th century than the Ukrainian, to a large degree. This was a result of both communist and Nazi activity in Ukraine. The Russian and the Germans were savage, but the Jews were the worst. They betrayed their neighbors and did it with such zeal. It's a pure lie, as you know.
And so what I think the general lesson is that we're seeing a return of Nazism and fascism under NATO, U.S.
Yes.
Auspices, and these are some of the things that they bring forward.
Yes, it's the same kind of campaign we see today. The slaughtered accused.
The victim is blamed. The victim is blamed. We're going to be back in a minute. 1 minute,
yes.
And we'll be back for our final segment on World Crisis Radio. Welcome back to our final segment of this week's World Crisis Radio. Webster Tarpley here in Washington, D.C., talking to Annie Lacroix, French historian of Ukraine in the 1930s, but also generally the fascist era in Europe in particular. I would like to shift, if we could, from Ukraine in the 30s to your general thesis that you've put forward in books like From Munich to Vichy, The Vatican, Europe, and the Third Reich, and the choice of defeat in particular. And the way we can do this, I hope, is I know it's Stepan Bandera that we've been talking about, the Nazi in Ukraine. There are probably 24 statues in Western Ukraine of Stepan Bandera.
Yes.
But in France, are there any statues of Marshal Pétain that you write about so much in these other books?
Yes, but you know, we in France have no statues, but of course, many fans of Pétain were left very powerful at the end of the war, or after the what we call the liberation.
Right.
And that's of course a difference between the situation in Western Ukraine and France today, because as we know, the rightist movements are directly from the movements protected and fostered by Roman Church, by the Vatican, because it's not developed these days in France. And we don't speak of the question of unitism, and we have no time now. We are going to speak of dictatorship in France too, but that's a very important problem. And
if I could, just in the couple of minutes we have left, I regard your work as the key not only to understanding France in the 1930s or 20s. The interwar period, but I think what you have done is also the key to understanding the United States in the 1930s, because the Morgan coup against Roosevelt, let's say, in 1934, we probably had 4 to 5 coup attempts against Roosevelt. We had attempted assassinations, and then I think a successful assassination, and you go through this in your book, The Coup of Marshal Lyautey in the 1920s, and then the one we've just had the anniversary of, the attack on the French National Assembly in February of 1934. Could you just state, for the listeners who have never heard of Synarchy or Cagoule, what this was?
The Synarchy was a very tiny group of financiers, of bankers mostly, and bankers whose interests were peculiarly important in the colonies in
the French
Africa,
Empire at the time.
Africa, Asia, not only the Banque Vance, but the Banque d'Indochine, la Banque Louis II, and so on. And these people began to foster a dictatorship project, not in the 30s, in the 20s. In 1922, it was the period when finance people were very attached to restore dictatorship. For two reasons: the crisis of the post-World War, the very difficult period from war economy to peace economy, and the deep anger of the Soviet Revolution, not only for ideological reasons, but because Russia was a very precious treasure, you know, foreign capital had taken possession of Russia. All the modern economy was foreign, and not only French, British, German, American too, and these people wanted, in the crisis of the economic crisis of the 20s, to reduce wages very hard, to maximize profits, and the only way to do this was to have very hard dictatorships. international bankers, among them, of course, French bankers, had settled the question of Italian debt by choosing the Mussolini solution. Not only French bankers, but British bankers, American bankers, and so on. And it's in the year 1922, which was so important for the settlement of dictatorship in Europe, it's in that year that the Synarchy was founded. At the beginning, with 12 persons. 12 bankers. We know 11 of them, but what we know is that in the 30s, there was the most powerful of these Synarchs were about 30. And in the 40s, we have the best list is the list of Henri Chavin for a kind of secretary for police, mm-hmm. one of the people named before René Bousquet, who is more famous. Henri Chavin gave to Pétain a list of the most important. There were less than 50, and the most famous of them were at that time, because the list was of 1941, at the beginning of the regime de Vichy, the most important of them were both bankers or industrial people and secretaries in the Vichy government, because in the Vichy government they take all the aspects of the power, of the political power, which was relatively new. It's more usual in the United States that a banker is a treasury secretary, you know. It was mm-hmm. it was not the habit. It was not the custom in France. Vichy made that, and this Synarchy was the French imperialism is rather weak since the beginning of the peculiar phase of capitalism. And it has taken the habit to look for protectors.
All right, I'm so sorry. We've run out of time. The music tells us our time is gone. We've been honored to talk to Annie Lacroix. I hope we can get her back soon. Let me just tell you, if you want to try your luck reading some French, her website is called Historiographie. And that is historiography as in English, except drop the Y at the end and add IE. So you get www.historiographie.info. And there you can find the 60-page document, I believe, about the Holodomor. Thank you very much. We hope we can get you back soon. And we're sorry we didn't have enough time to finish as much as we wanted. But at least it's a good beginning. See you next week on World Crisis Radio.